Camo Church. Lord, I have the opportunity and the privilege to introduce our guest, exempt preacher, for the hour. But first, I have to take this point of privilege and just say a couple of words about Pastor David McIntosh-Peters. First, Pastor, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your example, character. Thank you for your example, not even example, thank you for your friendship. Thank you for your time, thank you for your ear, thank you for your energy towards not just me, but my son and I, and obviously my family. You don't always like change and seasons, but we accept it.
Yes.
And as believers, we know that all things work together for the good. So we should thank God for the season that He gave you to Mount Sinai. But we also are rooting and excited about this season that you have us in. Man, I got that off my chest. I'm not going to read my Pastor Tyrone Queen's bio. It's right there for your own reading. But let me just say this. My pastor is a man of character and commitment. In a world where that's just a punchline nowadays, in a world where you can look at the White House and say it's non-existent, you can look at Congress and say it's non-existent, it's refreshing to be around men of character.
Yeah.
And each Sunday, each during the week, I get to be around a true man of character. So I'm presenting to you all someone who walks the Word, knows how to teach the Word, and I'm just very excited to hear what God has to say through him. And we're excited about the Word. So after, I guess, the preparation hymn, we'll hear from my pastor, Pastor Tyrone Queen.
Amen. Amen.
Oh,
subject to Pastor Young, our worship leader,
Amen.
To all the distinguished guests that he represented, various organizations, to my fellow pastors, subject to the officers, members of Salem, officers and members of the sign of the good deed and the love. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm so honored and excited to be here to celebrate this moment in the life of this church, in the life of this family, Amen. We're happy for the church. We're happy for the Peters family. And certainly you have our prayers and we have Mount Sinai's support. That's perfect. Father, thank you. Privilege of being your children, being entrusted with your work to represent you in this world. Thank you for the legacy of the Salem Baptist Church, members, families, people who have given and contributed and served over the years. Thank you now for this new marriage, new relationship. We pray. Preacher, his family, we pray, even now as I share with them your truth, that you would open our understanding of minds and hearts to receive your word. Thank you for what you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I have two texts this afternoon. One is in Joshua chapter 1. The other couple of verses is in Psalm 78. Joshua 1. Beginning at verse 5. The King James Version reads this way: No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage. To this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous. You may observe to do according to the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left. You may make prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You shall meditate in it day and night. You may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous. And then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed. The Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And then a few verses from Psalm 78, down about verse 70. He also chose David, his servant, and took him from the sheepfolds, from following the ewes that had the young. He brought him to shepherd Jacob, his people, and Israel, his inheritance. So he shepherded them according to the integrity of his heart and guided them by the skillfulness of his hands. I want to talk about the promise of his presence.
All right.
This word, this passage, this people, the promise of God's presence. Joshua had been servant to Moses for about 40 years. He was waiting for Moses when Moses came down from the mountain to get the law from the Lord. He was waiting to meet him. He was there to meet Moses when he came. Went up the mountain, and when he came back down, he was with him. Joshua served in the shadow of that word leader for 40 years. And it would have been okay with Joshua if Moses stayed around and kept leading. He was content to be the second one in charge under Moses. But the day came when God moved Moses on. And now the one who had served as the mouth of God for the people for all these years had gone. And the responsibility of leadership now fell to Joshua.
Yeah.
He would be known now to lead the people. He could not depend on merely following Moses. Now the people would look to him as the first leader. He must have felt, I would imagine, quite honestly, overwhelmed. So it's interesting to me how God prepared him for the task. The Lord says to him repeatedly that as I was with Moses,
yes,
so I will be with you.
Yeah.
That's what he says not only to Moses, Pastor Peters, but that's what he says to you in this church today. It's the promise of God's continuing presence. God uses this promise to call his people to trust him in new seasons and challenges of their day. He said the same thing when he called Moses in Exodus 3 to go bring the people out of Egypt. Moses complained, "Who am I? Well, I should go to Pharaoh and tell him to let the people go." And the Lord merely said, "I will surely be with you." And when Gideon was just a farmer, and the Midianites were harassing them, an angel showed up and said, "You've been chosen to go lead Israel into battle." And Gideon said, "Who am I to go? I'm just a farmer. I don't know what to do." And the Lord merely said to him, "Surely I will be with you." And when King David had led Israel for all those years and passed off the scene, God repeated this promise to young Solomon. 1 Kings 11:38, God said to Solomon, "If you will hearken to all I command you, and to walk in my ways, and do what is right in my sight, and keep my statutes and commandments, as David my father did, then it will be true that I will be with you and build you a sure house, just as I built for David. And I will give Israel to you." So this is not a promise that was just true for one time and one leader. This is a continuing refrain that God makes to his people, his leaders he chose. "As I was with those who led for me and led my work in the past, so I will be with you." So I want to encourage you, first of all, to claim the promise of God's presence. Hebrews 13:5 makes it clear that this is true for us in our day. Whatever your situation, God says, "Know this, I will never leave you nor forsake you." Someone said that when God assures us of his assistance, it is so we will roll up our sleeves and take action. He does not tell us so we will sit down and wait for him to do something. He tells us so we will get up and know that we will have his help. Notice that the Lord gave this new leader Joshua three commands in this text that I want to highlight. And these commands apply to God's leaders in every age. He says to him, first of all, since you're going to be aware of my presence, as you practice my presence, as you trust the promise of my presence, then you need to be practicing courageous faith. Right there, verses 6 and 7. Repeat again in verse 9. Again, be strong and of good courage. You shall divide the inheritance to this people. You need to practice, Joshua, courageous faith. You need to believe that you will do what I have called you to do. And to do it, you must have courage. Moses said this to Joshua when he was about to pass off the scene. David said the same thing to his son Solomon in his book as he was passing off the scene. And now God repeats the same promise to young Joshua. Be strong. Be of good courage. Do not be afraid.
Yeah.
I was afraid. Because there were real, new, and unforeseen challenges. He must lead the people to conquer cities that had withstood many battles. They were going to face skilled armies. They would face combined attacks from several kings. 40 years earlier, the nation did not want to go forward. They were afraid of the challenges ahead of them. They wanted to go back to Egypt instead of moving forward in God's plan. Fear is usually our companion when we face new challenges. What if things don't work out? But if we give in to our fears, if you don't fight your fears, then your fears will take over your life. Someone said, without courage, you're not just living, you're just hiding. As Brown said, too many of us are not living our dreams because we're living our fear. You can't lead this people unless you lead with courage. You have to show up for the fight and face your challenges. Make the best plan you can. Put your faith in the Lord. He will always be there, but just show up for the battle. Faith does not require your fear to go away. God was saying to Joshua, you may be afraid, but don't be a slave to your fear. God called on him to demonstrate a challenge by moving the work forward. Notice that when you count on God to keep his promise, it produces strength and spirit so you can take on the challenge. The second thing, though, to make it happen to move forward, you have to make obeying God your priority. Verse 7, only be strong, be courageous, that you may observe to do all of things that I have commanded you. Don't turn from it to the right hand and to the left. You're going to have to make it a priority to obey God. God emphasizes obedience to his commands as a priority for his servant leaders. And God ties success in his word to obedience to him. And Peter, you've been called to be God's servant in leading this people. You need to know you are first God's servant before you are the people's leader. You are successful in this congregation only if you stay true to following God and his ways. The words of Psalm 78, 70 help us here when it tells us the reason why God chose David was because he was first God's servant. Scripture says he chose David, his servant, to be the leader of his people. Joshua first proved to be a servant to Moses before he was the leader of the people. Joshua not only was a servant to Moses, but Joshua learned to be true to God. Joshua hung around the tent of meeting. Joshua established his own relationship with the Lord. If you're going to lead this people, you have got to be committed to be God's servant. That's why God chose him. And notice, remember what God called David? A man after my own heart. This text says about him that he shepherded Israel with integrity of heart. That word integrity literally means one heart. It's the opposite of a double-minded man. James says it's unstable in all his ways. You will lead this people well only if you choose to stay true to being God's servant first and the people's leader second. Not only was David a man of integrity, David was a man of skill. He guided them with the skillfulness of his hands. You need integrity, but you also need skill as a leader. No amount of dedication can compensate for a lack of skill. No amount of skill will compensate for a lack of dedication. You need both. There's a skill and an art to leading God's people. The leadership in God's church is about creating a unified team and getting everyone involved in the work. If you're just trying to juggle all the things yourself, you are not leading. Your charge is not to do it all yourself. Your charge is to pull around you committed people who will roll up their sleeves and be in the fight with you. You're going to lead your team. I always like this. I heard it many years ago. I think I heard Dr. Warren Wordsworth say it. Some leader from Southern Baptist who said year after year after year, in the work of the Lord, everything rises and falls with leadership. I am convinced that that is true. In the work of the Lord, everything rises and falls with leadership. Not only must you lead, but you need skill and integrity and the help of the Lord to call around you people who are servant leaders who will join with you in the work. Imagine yourself as a new foreman coming to a job site. Building has already been started. The work project has been going on for some time. As a new foreman, you come to a work already in progress.
Yeah.
You have to inspect where the work is. You have to figure out what skilled workers are available to do the work. Now the foreman that is called to follow is called to follow the plans of the master designer.
Yeah.
And you have to remember that God has a plan for this church. God has a plan for this work. As you call around you and seek to build a team of people who are committed to go with you, you see what skill they have. You still have to make sure you're leading everybody to keep looking at the Lord's plan. You have to remember that there is a work to be done through the people, and there is a work to be done in the people. Probably won't get done tonight, so you have to pace yourself. Sometimes you have to focus on one section of the work and leave another section alone. Sometimes you have to stop doing the work and focus on the workers. I'm convinced if the workers are who they should be, the work will be what it should be. The most important decisions I ever make is the selection of leaders. Because we don't have time to fight among ourselves. And you want leaders who will help you go forward. You want leaders who calm storms, not create storms. You want leaders who will help you to speak with one voice in this church. In the Supreme Court just ruled, made a decision about who can speak about its borders, and they made it clear that if somebody is speaking for the nation, that person needs to speak with one voice. It can't be Congress and the president. The president needs to speak on this matter. And Salem and Pastor Peters, when we're trying to figure out which way the church ought to go, the church needs to speak with one voice. We just need to get around one leader. We need to talk it through and debate it through, but we go forward with one voice. Let me go back to the text then.
Come on, sir.
Joshua. Final thing in that text that is important is that God reminds him that you have to prioritize time in God's word. Verse 8, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You will meditate in it day and night, and you may observe to do everything that's written in it. That's the way you will have prosperity in this world. Joshua and the people were to read God's word, read it aloud. The book was to stay with him all the time. They would go over it again and again. That word meditate actually means that the habit of thinking and turning the thoughts, the truths of God's instructions over and over again in our mind and heart. Amen. That we may be captivated with God's word. You have to lead this congregation. Meditate in the word of God. Amen. If you want God to lead you and be with you, you have got to spend time with him. I would encourage you, Salem, to make sure he has time to spend with the Lord. I hope you want someone who is hearing from the Lord. If you want someone who is hearing from the Lord, then you have to help protect his time. So no matter what he's doing through the week, no matter who he's visiting, no matter who he's counseling, no matter what ministry guidance he's giving, when it gets to the end of the week on Sunday morning, when the church comes together, the question of everybody's mind and heart is there a word from the Lord? And he's been dealing with every issue. If all the problems are on his doorstep, if he's trying to solve every issue, then it's going to be hard for him to stand in this pulpit and be able to say, thus says the Lord. in the word and to pray. Mind the word, y'all? When the apostles were challenged to take care of the administrative needs of a growing church in Jerusalem, they said, it is not right for us to leave the word of God to serve tables. We are not the only gifted people in here. God has gifted people in this church. And the church goes forward when the people roll up their sleeves and say, how do we go forward, Pastor? Together. And things that you can take, you should take.
Yeah.
All right. So we can have priority time with the Lord. They said, we will give ourselves to pray and the word of God.
Yeah.
No. Don't get me wrong. You need to be in some meetings.
Yeah.
You need to be in the meeting of your leaders. A pastor has to lead the leaders.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
You can't have somebody leading one way and you're trying to lead another way. Pastor has to lead the leaders. I don't know where Salem is. I haven't talked to Reverend Peters. I tell you another thing, we struck with it at Mount Sinai. The pastor needs to be able to choose who's going to be his chair of the deacon and the trustee.
All right, yeah.
Yes, sir.
I'm leaving, so I don't have to feel like it. I've been pastoring long enough. First thing you want to do is make sure you got the right man. People think it's our job to keep watching over the pastor, then you haven't called the right man.
Come on, sir.
First job is call a man who has a man, a heart for God. A man or woman has a heart for God. And when you've done that and prayed about it, if you see the person walk in integrity, then you ought not be trying to hinder, you ought to be trying to help. But I found over the years is that sometimes people already have their own agenda of where they think things should go. So you have to spend a few years trying to figure out getting the rain out of somebody's hand so you can lead forward. Y'all can waste time if you want, or we can all get on board so we can go in one direction. Meditation over. You can't have courage without being with the Lord. Spend time with them.
Yeah.
You gotta listen to the people. You need to hear the people, but don't let the people drown out the voice of God in your ears.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. It's wonderful to come to the pulpit with a sense that you heard from the Lord.
Yeah.
It's wonderful to come to the pulpit knowing that you have spent time in His word and spent time in prayer.
Yeah.
And you can trust God to speak to you and through you.
Yeah.
And you want to come to the pulpit having prioritized time with God.
Yes, sir.
Because if you're going to leave this congregation, you need to leave them with hope.
Yeah.
They need a hopeful word.
Yeah.
Everybody's finished dealing with illnesses during the week, and dealing with challenges at work, and dealing with family matters. The people need a word of hope.
Yes.
They need courage. Yes. They need to be encouraged and strengthened. Yes. And you can't have hope for them if you don't get hope from the Lord. You have to be with the Lord. Amen. You have to come ready to say that we can look up to our God. I'm reminded, I'm almost done, but I love the story of, it's really actually not a story, but actually an experiment. Some years ago, researchers put some mice in a little cave, in a little tub, and they left them in there, put water in, and the little mice had to swim in that little tub. And they left them there, and in 24 hours, every mice fell to the bottom and died. Then they repeated the experiment with a new tub and new mice. They put them in the tub, and they filled it with water, and the mice began swimming. They did one thing different. They reached down. Somebody reached down and held, took the mice up and put it back down. Someone reached down and picked another mouse up and put it back down. Did it several times. Then stood back and watched. And for 24 hours, they kept swimming. Nobody drank because they kept waiting for a hand in a moment to reach down and give them some help. And when people come on Sunday morning, they need a hand. But there's a God among us who's going to reach down just when we need it and give us some help.
No doubt, having been there at the time of the ordination, Reverend Dave McIntosh-Peters. I'm really excited about this opportunity to stand here today to give this charge. There's no doubt that the message, the word of God that we receive from Pastor Queen today could serve, really no doubt, as the charge.
Yes, sir.
I could just have a seat. Since I did prepare a little something. Allow me just this moment to give this charge to you, Pastor Peters. For years you have been making preparation, I believe, for this very moment. Preparation to practice with passion the purpose that God has for you in this pastoral ministry. Some years ago, and I was reminded as I was preparing this, I read the book by Gardner C. Taylor and Samuel D. Proctor, We Have This Ministry. And these words were taken from that book. It says, the pastor is called to give purpose, meaning, coherence, direction, and authenticity to the human sojourner, and then have the audacity to insist on a grand surmise about the journey's end. That's the role, I think, summed up by Dr. Gardner C. Taylor and Dr. Samuel Dewey Proctor, for the pastor in this journey, because you're more than, as has been stated, more than a preacher. You've been called to pastor, which is the biblical term of shepherding and leading and guiding. So Pastor David McIntosh-Peters, I want to charge you based upon what we just heard from Dr. Gardner C. Taylor and Dr. David Proctor to fulfill your passion, your purpose, your calling, that you would teach with passion. Every moment is going to be a teaching moment. Every meeting, it's going to be a teaching moment. Many sessions that you find yourself in, you will find it as a teaching moment. Teach. It won't just be in Bible study. It won't just be in those formal settings, but there will be individual ones, one-on-one times, small times when you will be teaching. Preach. Preach with power. Just heard, you've got to hear from God.
That's right.
You are the voice of God. You are the resident theologian,
Lord,
for this congregation.
That's right.
You have a responsibility to speak for God. Sometimes it will feel good to those who hear. And there will be other times that it will hurt and cut. But when you cut, you cut with the word. And you make folks feel good. Make them feel good. Word. Be the voice of God. You'll need to be the voice of God because we have injustice around us. And you're so close to the White House. The White House needs to hear the voice of God. There is injustice. Be the voice of God. Keep things in order. That means you're going to need to administrate. You're going to have to keep things decently and in order. You're going to need to intercede. You're going to be the intercessor for your people. You're going to be crying out days and nights for your people and who the God has given you, the shepherd. You're going to be an intercessor, a counselor. But all that you do, do this with passion. Do it as a person who is alive. Howard Thurman says, don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive. And go do it. Because what the world needs is people. Let me add, pastors who have come alive.
Yeah.
And so, Pastor Peters, under the power of God, I too challenge you. I too charge you. Shepherd Salem Baptist Church with the integrity of heart and with the skillfulness of hands.
First, giving honor to the Spirit of Christ and to Pastor, I guess I should still say Pastor-elect right now, Pastor-elect David McIntosh-Peters, Mrs. Peters, Pastor Queen, Mrs. Queen, other members of the clergy, members, officers, members, friends of Salem, which I'm proud and glad to be counted amongst that number.
Yeah.
It's certainly good for me to be here today and play this little part on this awesome service occasion. And let's give God another hand of praise. So we have enjoyed the singing of this choir as well. Today God is good. Now, I want the members of Salem, officers, members of staff, and I'd like to know who I'm talking to. Today. You can remain standing first. Let me commend you on your choice. David McIntosh, he used to be your pastor. To be very frank and honest with you, I don't think you could have made a better choice. My little dads take the time today to tell you all of the good things that I have noticed in him just by observing him. Not in Mount Sinai, but away from Mount Sinai. All preachers are not the same away than at home. Another thing I like about McIntosh Peters is that he has proven to be good, faithful, and loyal assistant. Anyone who cannot follow, cannot lead. Amen. I had the privilege of presiding over his election here, and it was just great. And I said something then to the few members that was here at the end. I want to say to you today that I was in charge, I was presiding, I was in charge, but I had four people that made sure we did everything right. David Wilson, Sister Alexander, Dr. Smallwood, I believe from First Baptist, and the Deacon from Brooklyn Union. I know we counted all the votes at least four times. Make sure that it was correct. So whether you voted for him or against you, him, he's duly elected.
Well,
he's your pastor. Even if you didn't vote at all, he's still a pastor. I believe that. Just move on in and do my little, rest of my little charge. About 30 or 35 years ago, late Dr. Harold Trammell from Mount Jezebel Baptist Church, over the southeast at that time, when we moved up town here, and he was going around doing a church institute. And the boy from St. Matthew's would come to the church and he said something about being fat. F-A-T, fat. Now, ladies, it don't have nothing to do with the size of your dress, size of your shoes, size of your hair. Men, it don't have nothing to do with the size of your suit or anything like that. And he said, you got to be faithful, available, and teachable. So I'm charging number one to be faithful. Moreover, says Paul, he said Corinthians 4 and 2, 1 Corinthians 4, more requires stewards than a man be found faithful.
Faithful.
Yeah. Be faithful in your prayer life.
Yeah. Yeah.
You pray for your pastor, and not just your pastor, but pray for his wife.
Yeah.
Pray for his children. I hate to hear people praying for the pastor all the time and never praying for his wife. Something wrong with that picture. Pray for him and pray for his family. They need prayer also. And I don't know anything that a preacher needed more than prayer. So be faithful in praying for the pastor and his family. And be faithful in your church attendance.
Yeah, yeah.
And you got a new pastor. He needs your help. He needs your support.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You ain't got no business running around in town, here, there, and everywhere. It's your church. Be faithful. Yeah, be faithful in your church attendance. Be faithful in supporting the program that the pastor put in front of the church. Amen. Be faithful in your giving. Amen. Be faithful in your giving, your tithes. And number two, be available. Challenge you to be available. I don't care how smart you are, how much you know, how many degrees, what kind of job you have, how big the houses you live in, how many automobiles you have in your driveway. Now you need to be available. You can have all that other stuff going for you. But if you're never available, time passed as you do something, but I wish it was yesterday. It got to be available. It got to be teachable.
Yeah.
I find that a lot of our churches, people who need to be taught are the ones who are never available.
Yeah.
If you have a conference or whatever, Sunday school, if they have Bible, anything that's going to be some teaching, they don't never have time. And then some of them, they know so much stuff. They know more than anybody else. And I would tell people to be careful about that. There was a man who thought he was the smartest man in the world. And he got on the airplane with the President of the United States. Not only President, but he got up with a soldier and a Baptist preacher. And they were doing all right until they got about 35,000 feet in the air. And the last engine went out. And the problem they had was they didn't have but three parachutes. The boy's probably the smartest one jumped out first. Baptist preacher, the soldier, the president said, no, I got to have one so I can go back and run the country. Left the president, left the Baptist preacher, and the soldier. And the Baptist preacher said to the soldier, say, oh, son, you just take the last one, I'm old. I'll stay here and pray. And the soldier said, Rick, we ain't got no problem. So what do you mean you ain't got no problem? Said, that boy's supposed to be the smartest man in the world. So you jumped out in my duffel bag. So I charge you. Don't try to be the smartest person in the church. But if you get anything I said, remember to be faithful. Because if you're faithful, when you come to the end of your journey, even if the pastor forget to say anything about you and call your name, he'll understand.
Yeah.
say, well, no. One more thing. Since you put my brother's middle initiative in beside my name,
all right,
I got to say that one thing for him. And I don't mind you doing that. That was a C guy. Amen. I'm Maxwell Leon. Amen. But you would want me to say to you, walk together, children. Yeah. Don't you get married? Don't be a good family.
Everything that has breath, praise the Lord. We've had a glorious time here at Salem Baptist Church all day, especially this afternoon. Dr. Queen for challenging us this afternoon. I'll give a further remarks later on. Let me get to the task that has been assigned to me, the installation of the covenant. Will all Salem members stand again? And we're going to read this installation covenant responsibly. Do you, the members of Salem Baptist Church, believe in yourself to be led by the Holy Spirit, affirm your call of the Reverend David McIntosh-Peters to be your pastor?
We do so affirm, God being our witness and our help.
Having affirmed your call of Reverend David McIntosh-Peters as your pastor, and understanding that a covenant agreement is made in the sight of God and man, do you now covenant to care for his needs and welfare and support him by your presence and work?
We do so covenant, God be our witness and our help.
Do you further covenant to pray for the ministry of this church, for your pastor and his family, and to allow his family to be church members just like anyone else?
We do so covenant, God be our witness and our help.
Understanding that change is inevitable, do you covenant to make sacrifices of your preferences and desires for the greater good of the church?
We do so covenant, God be our witness and our help.
Finally, do you now covenant to pray for and demonstrate love for one another even when you disagree?
We do so covenant, God be our witness and our help.
Reverend McIntosh-Peters, do you, the Reverend David McIntosh-Peters, believe in yourself in accord with God's will, accept the call of Salem Baptist Church to be its pastor?
I do so accept, God be my witness and my helper. Further, I am humbled and honored that you have called me to be your pastor. I'm also grateful that you recognize the need for change in order for our church to become healthier. As your pastor, I covenant to pray for you daily, to love you, to listen to you, to be transparent with you, to be a faithful student of God's word, that I may preach and teach to glorify him and edify you. I further covenant, through the aid of the Holy Spirit, to lead Salem Baptist Church in innovative change strategies that will prepare us to be the Church of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Salem, together we will
stood here many times in the last few months, and I'm so happy. To my friend, to my pastor. So let us express to God our thankfulness on what He has given to us. The ministry of Christ Church is a ministry of the entire church, pastor and people together. We all have a responsibility to answer the great commission of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and to respond with this promise and empowering of the Holy Spirit. As ambassadors of Christ, we strive to reconcile mankind to God and to each other. As Christians, we serve according to our several gifts and responsibilities given to us by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in that Salem Baptist Church, led by the Holy Spirit, has called the Reverend David McIntosh-Peters to be our pastor. We do now give God thanks.
Amen. We do now give Salem Baptist Church. We do now give our thanks for joining us in the covenant to care for our pastor's major needs, sustain him with our prayers, and encourage him with our enthusiastic labor in all the tasks God gives us.
And after 20 months, Pastor David McIntosh-Peters will lead the people of Salem Baptist Church. Pastor, I turn it over to you.
Privilege to ask that if Pastor Peters, prepared.